For hundreds of years, the mountains of Mourne have inspired countless stories, poems, and songs. Yet when it comes to leaving a lasting impression in this part of the world, these mountains have a rival. In 1960, a group of Down Gaelic footballers began a journey on this pitch, the old county ground here in Newcastle. When it ended, what they had achieved inspired generations of footballers who followed. Their names aren't just carved onto Mourne granite, they're etched into GAA history.
Never before in over seven decades of GAA history was a victory so widely acclaimed. Down had changed the seemingly unalterable course of history and humbled the greatest football county of them all in the process. Kevin Musson has become the first man from across the border to receive the Sam Maguire Cup and to be congratulated by Uachtaráin na hÉireann. What a momentous occasion this is, not only for Kevin and his teammates, not only for the wildly exuberant supporters of the Stars of the County Down, but for every man in Ireland. The unrestrained scenes of exultation continued for several minutes after the game had ended, and the men, women, and the children too, from the mountains of Mourne, rightly decided that this was a fitting occasion for a special parade of their own. And every heart in Ireland, especially those of Kerry, the fallen champions, echoed the foremost sentiment of the day. Ceadh míle fáilte agus chomh gortachas do léirithe an dua.
St. Colman's College in Newry, a school with a rich Gaelic football tradition. Several of the Down players were educated here. They're back to meet the current McCrory Cup side. This is where most of the team assembled on the morning of the All-Ireland final 50 years ago. And today, they're going to take that journey to Croke Park again. There were a few absentees on the morning of the journey. Illness prevented Seamus Kennedy from travelling. George Lavery, Sean O'Neill and John Haughian didn't take part for personal reasons. James Fitzpatrick lives in Canada.
What sort of memories did that bring back for you?
Fascinating. The very first McCrory Cup team, Veltel team to win. I happened to have the good luck to be on it. So it was great to see that again. And it was along with Leo.
Oh, where's Leo?
Leo.
Leo features prominently in 2 or 3 later on, along with my brother.
Now, the reason for going to St. Colman's was just for handiness, really. At that time, people all went to Mass, so it was a handy place to have the Mass, and the college very decently offered it to us, and so many of their own past pupils were playing, the McCartans and Liam Murphy and Patsy O'Hagan, that it was a sort of a welcome home for them too.
For years we had various drivers that would collect it, and the late Danny Flynn, who happened to train us, would always have picked myself up, Pat Rice and Patsy O'Hagan, and we would have travelled everywhere together in his car. So he picked us up and took us there. Could very well be that we went straight to the hotel and not to Mass.
But there was Mass said.
So I believe. Getting back this morning now takes it up. Though we left the O'Hare Hotel on Hill Street, we left from there. We didn't leave from the college. There wasn't that many about that morning we're leaving. You'd imagine the crowds would be about nowadays if a team was leaving for the final in the middle of Main Street. You know, but it was an absolutely great day, and it was great to be part of the panel.
Where did you sit on the bus in 1960?
I didn't. I was doing the September handicap, repeating an exam in Dublin. So I came across from the digs instead, and on a bus to meet them at the hotel.
So did you feel detached a bit that weekend because you weren't with them on the journey going down?
Well, I probably felt detached most of the time because I was a student in Dublin when they were training here in the north, and I had actually trained with Lansdowne Rugby Club. And I also, at the time, because there was no training for the rugby boys, went in. I played soccer and rugby myself with this college I was in. Illegally, like, I got suspended, but nobody, I played on my Christian names were Brian Mooney Daniel, so I played on the Brian Mooney, and nobody knew me. At that stage, there was no televisions, so people didn't know you as well as they would nowadays. You wouldn't get away with nowadays, but I got away with then.
Was there much crack on the bus on the way down?
We just prayed.
you know, we just prayed and hoping that everything would go well. You know, that's what I meant.
We stopped in the Clare Manor and we stopped in another one. I just can't mind the name of it now.
The Maples?
Yes, the Maples. It's just a wee bit up to the right of Croke Park, and when we were out there, the we were kicking football on the road, and the Garda came up and notebooks out and all, they were going to prosecute us, and Mark came over and says, that's the Down team you're prosecuting. So
you nearly got arrested on the morning of the All-Ireland?
Nearly got arrested.
On the day of our journey, of the 15 players who started the 1960 final, three were deceased. Breen Morgan, Jarlath Carey and Pat Rice.
Patricia, what do you think Dad would have made of this sort of get-together?
He would have loved it. He would have really enjoyed it. I think the main thing that we sort of picked up from the team was the friendship between them all, and I think he would have really enjoyed it.
Every match we went, I always would have made a point that if Patricia's mother wasn't going, I was forcing the car, because the people you met at the games, and if you're walking past, they say, oh, there's Pat Rice, you know, and it made you feel very humble that you were alongside him, and it was great, absolutely brilliant, and the dues you went to.
He was very, very proud of it and realised how lucky he was to be part of that team. And he would often talk about the very, very good footballers he knew who were never lucky enough to get an All-Ireland medal, so many of them. So he was very grateful that he was part of the whole thing. And in those days, strangely enough, Jarlath was quite an unusual name and it seemed to stick in people's minds.
He also had a very bad haircut. I remember meeting a priest in the Irish College in Leuven in Belgium, of all people, and he was a football fan from the 60s, and he heard the name and he knew it was from the north and said, you're nothing to that fella that played for Down with the long flowing locks. So I think that maybe helped him stand out a bit as well.
Which you're continuing today?
Yes.
Aye. Well, I just thought in honour. Did it great specially.
Did doctors get nervous on All-Ireland final day, or a different sort of responsibility for you, was it?
Well, way back in 1960, we didn't have to worry about psychologists, people like that. There didn't seem to be a need for them then. And certainly dealing with the board in 1960 compared to this present century, you didn't have to worry about them drinking. For example, there was no necessary to have a ban on drinking, and you never thought of that really. The players were totally committed, they were a lovely bunch of players, and in my experience, every successful team that we've had, they've always been a very humble group of players, no prima donnas, but every player would play their heart out, not only for themselves and the jersey, but for their comrades.
You're making them sound like a dream team.
Well, they were a dream team, there's no doubt about that. And I mean, they were better than we realised.
And they didn't worry about dietitians either. When the team arrived at the Maples Hotel, the pre-match breakfast wasn't a day fair. The players at stake.
There was a sort of notion at that time you should play on an empty stomach, when you get sort of tea and biscuits before the match, and as if that weren't bad enough, you then get ham salad afterwards, you know. So we threw that away. Basically, we were trying to give people what not everybody wanted, a steak. I mean, some people want a poached egg or something like that, but by and large, most of them wanted steaks, and they had their steak before the match and burned off their energy then with that, and it didn't seem to do any of them any harm. We had some players that you knew were exceptional players. I mean, you knew that Paddy Doherty was a match winner. You knew that Sean O'Neill was match winner on a day. But, I mean, to be match winners, they needed 9 or 10 or 12 other people to be operating at a high level of efficiency too. And on a day when one good player was sort of being kept quiet or marked out of it, there was always to stand in and take it on, you know. Patsy O'Hagan was an amazing player. I thought he was enormously versatile and suffered as a result, because he never could make a name for himself in any one place. But if we had a hole that needed plugged, I mean, Patsy was the person to put into it, you know.
We were a team, you know. No one player was going to win it for us, but he played as a team, and every man looked after his nearest neighbour. I admired every one of them. Every one of them had their own strong points. You know, from goalkeeper to number 15, everybody put their best into every game. In our day now, it was a simple game played cleanly and hard at times, but never dirty.
Jumpers and everything.
I had a friend was a big baseball player.
He didn't want to see my face.
He could throw that speedball by you. Make you know.
The only two players that didn't play were goalkeeper and left cornerback.
Us the dumb players, how comfortable these seats are, God, there might be a takeover bit again.
Shot more for the honour of Down. And it was those were the sentiments that we went out to meet Kerry, that we were in a real battle and we were going to do our utmost.
My memories, and I was only a wee lad at the time, just the memory of your football and the skill that you brought to the game and the new presence that you brought and the change you brought to Gaelic football around that time was immense. You probably don't realise it for us watching you and play so well and the contribution that you made to Gaelic football at the time, and really opened it up as a different type of Gaelic football, fast moving and open game. And we want to thank you for your immense contribution to that, and you can see how it's moved on since then. So well done on that, and again it's great to have you here.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Thanks. It was unbelievable at the time that we found ourselves playing Kerry in a football match in Croke Park for the All Ireland final. And my memories of the day are just being here and winning and remembering it ever since.
Lovely to be back and see all the faces, see them all looking so well, and wondering how in the name of goodness have they managed to keep themselves in such great form. Of course, we're missing a few players, sadly, but that's how life goes on. I mean, look at Leo Murphy over there, look at Kieran Denver, they're as fresh in the face as they were 30 years ago. It's good to see them all, and it's great to get back and meet them all again.
Kevin, did you say anything beforehand?
Yes. Which way will we play if I win the toss? That's all I said.
The red and black flags of County Down.